Okay, so here we are, and a very good afternoon to all the participants here. And I can see the chat messages as well, so that's something great. Okay, so it's morning for some, it's afternoon for some, it's noon here in India, and wishing everybody a very, very happy Diwali and a very happy and healthy New Year. It's a New Year today. So just a few things first, that what is this workshop all about and what are your expectations from this workshop? It's something that I would really like to know, if you can put it up in the chat. And by the time you answer it, let me also keep talking, because that's why we are here today, just for talking. All right, so there are two major things, major concerns when we are talking about any online course. And specifically, if we are going to talk about OER, because this is OE Global. But it's not only limited to being restricted to only OER. Any course that if you would like to conduct, even if it's going to be an OER MOOC or any other MOOC or any other limited audience online course, there are two basic concerns that we all have. And that is what we are actually going to talk about. The whole thing began because of the forced pandemic situation that forced us all to enter into the field, maybe less prepared, maybe unprepared, maybe, you know, just learning on the go or whatever it is. But there was this rush in creating, because there is this thought process in most of the educators' mind that if I'm going to teach online, I need my own videos. So what happened is something very alarming, or maybe disturbing. At the same time, it forces us to take a pause. Now, what is that? Let's just see. Well, the thing is, this is a minute on the internet in 2020. And we can see here that we have 500 hours of videos which are uploaded on YouTube every single minute of 2020. Now, if 500 hours of videos are going to be uploaded on the YouTube every single minute, we can just imagine the clutter that we are having on the internet. Now, that also makes us to think that, oh my God, if you just try to Google even one word, what's going to have or what's going to happen is nothing but this. Do we have this type of a feeling? How many of us have? Can we just have some raised hands or something like that? That, oh my God, if I click even one word, I'm going to get thousands and thousands of, you know, hits there. So just let's imagine our students. Yeah, I can see one hand. Thank you, Madhuri. Yes, because the moment even if I put one simple word as a Sunday, I'm going to get so many videos or, you know, something. And there is a time when almost after three or four searches, almost the content looks the same. Then why do we need to create? Remember, what if now this is something which we all face very often, and we all say this, that what if, you know, today Shakespeare were to be there? Would he also think of this? Instead of having to be or not to be a question, he would think that to blog or not to blog is the question, because there are so many blogs out there, and what to write, whose blog to read, how many resources, and God knows how many things are we going to, you know, actually be able to even look at that. So there was this very nice research conducted by a content learning or e-learning company, that it's not that, Derek Moore is saying that any online course needs to be learner-centered. Yes, and we are going to do that learner-centricity itself. Thank you, Derek. Thank you for that. The whole purpose is, because what happens is, if we are, the problem is not about the content at all. In fact, the problem is having too much of content. Because then that is creating a problem, that exactly what to refer, how much to refer out of it, and so on and so forth. So here in this workshop, what we would like all the participants to know is, just first let us reduce the load on ourselves. We are not going to create any content because there are lots and lots of OERs that are available. And the whole purpose of open education is nothing but to repurpose them, to contextualize them, and to learn how to do it and use them. So it's about all the R's that we say are significant features of the open education as a whole umbrella. And that is why it's no more going to be, first question should not be that whether do I need to create. There is a lot of material created, but the whole purpose is going to be to bring in the learner centricity, as Derek has perfectly pointed out. So that's what we are actually going to deal with in this particular workshop. So if we have so many resources, then what do we do to bring in the learner centricity as well? Well, the answer to that in one word is actually curation. Now, any idea where do we use this word curation? Have we come across the word curation? Have the participants come across? So I would like to know if, yes, I think I have one answer here. How many of us know about what is curation? Yes, Deep. How to make it happen in the classroom in a fun and exciting way and make it learner-centric is what is the purpose all about. So since there are no answers about curation at such, should we go ahead? Modification is what Rekha ma'am is saying. Okay, so fine. So I'll give you a hint. And then after that, let's see, do we all understand what is curation? So the hint is here. Now, is this enough of a clue? This is a curated exhibit. This is like a museum collecting relevant information. Yes. I'm sorry if I'm going to pronounce it wrong, Pamela. Pamela, yes, we do collect relevant information. We organize information to make it meaningful. Okay, Madhuri, thank you for that. And also, there's one more message coming up. Filtering through information is what Myra. I'm sorry if I pronounce your name wrong. Okay, so we have seen curation as a particular, as a methodology, mostly in museums and in art exhibits, in art galleries. Now, we have never thought of it in education, but more or less, the online system of education works like a museum, like a art exhibition or something like that, because we have a lot of content, we have a lot of relevant information, which we are going to organize, we are going to filter it, and we are going to organize it in such a way that it becomes more meaningful. So all your points are going to be there here. And I would request either Madhuri, if she can, to just let me know if there are some chat messages, because it's becoming a little bit difficult to, I might miss out some chat messages. Is that okay with you, Madhuri? Or maybe even Marianne? All right. So what we are talking about in online education is about content curation. Now, content, we have lots of videos, we have lots of books, we have lots of ebooks, textbooks, and so on and so forth. So usually, content curation is what you all have rightly pointed out, is we have some aggregation, that is, we collect relevant information, then we filter off, that is, we distill, we elevate it, that is, we add information to it, we mix up, we mash up lots of OERs and create something of our own, we arrange it chronologically. Has any one of you tried to do this and found that, or can we imagine this to be done? And still, can you find out, or can you imagine that there is still some problem? I don't think this exactly works in an educational scenario. Do you think like that? You can answer in the chat. And I really don't mind if you can switch on your mics and talk as well, if that is allowed. But the chat is always there. So, fine. Do you think this would work in the educational scenario? Where let's say I pick up, maybe we are doing a particular topic, which I, Madhuri, Rekha ma'am, Beat, and Derek, we all have in common. And we all have our resources. So I just pull them together. I filter off. I add some information. I mix up two videos. I mix up one textbook chapter. And I arrange them chronologically. And I serve it. Will that serve the purpose? Or there is still something lacking when we are talking of the educational content? Okay. I can see that there is some chat which is coming up. Just give me a moment while I see the chat. Okay. It might work, says Madhuri, when we want to make it work. Okay. Yeah, but Madhuri says it might work. So there's still this question of might. What about the others? Will it work, or it might work, or still we need something to, you know, to do, or it still is something? It will serve the purpose, but we need to, Rekha ma'am says, we need to consider the contextuality. And Meera says, we need to have align with learning outcomes seems to be missing. Yes. So here we are going to see the difference, because we are going to learn to curate an entire course. So, and I'll tell you, this works fine, because for the open education program, which was OU for Better World, I actually conducted an entirely curated course, and it worked really well. It was an interdisciplinary, so it also comes out from my own experience and the lessons that I learned from that. So this workshop is going to give you straight from the ground, straight from the field, some inputs. All right, so the main difference when we talk about a museum and a educational scenario is that we need to have local content and alignment. And yes, so the major two things that we need to consider is the technology, not only at our side, but also at the student's side, and how much they can be, you know, what are the technological affordances at their side? Like Beat was just discussing that, and this is the common thing. Even in India, we have the same thing. Maybe I belong to a particular part where the power and the internet doesn't have so much of a problem, but not all parts in the world are lucky enough, we should say. So we need to consider the technological affordances at our learners' end also. And moreover, we have to seek to develop a participatory culture, because that is what is schooling all about, isn't it? School is never about the teacher talking and the students just listening passively. It's also about, you know, sharing the tiffin box, having some fun, making fun of others, learning, playing, those moments when actually there is no learning taking place, but there is a building up of a learning community. So all of this together, that is the participatory culture, is many a times missing. I won't say that it's always missing, but many a times that is what is missing in the online culture, online scenarios, is something that we need to bring in. Is this part agreeable to everybody? So that we can go ahead. So I'm assuming that yes, but it would be great if you would just put it in the chat that yes, you do agree with that it is the participatory culture, because once the culture is developed, at that time the students will learn how to actually contextualize, and it's not only about me learning from my teacher, it's all of us learning from each other as well. Yes, so Derek says curation works when you have in mind both the overarching organizing schema, but curation without appreciating the local content. Yes, absolutely. You have put it so well, Derek. Thank you so much. And so we go ahead. So these are the steps of curation in educational content. I purposely did not animate it, but yes, as Meera had very clearly said that what is missing in a museum piece is the learning outcome, what we saw in the previous part. But actually, no, even in the museums, every single exhibit or let's say a cubicle has got a learning objective, and that's how they actually curate content. Like suppose if it's going to be medieval pottery, then medieval pottery only would be exhibited there. So the whole learning outcome, the whole overarching principle would be to bring pottery and the medieval part. So here also, when we are going to talk, we have got this, the traditional classroom, we move linearly, but we also have to understand that in an online scenario, the students can come out of one particular module, and they also are many a times, should, I would say should, but I would also say that are, because we do keep some control, that they are going to meander into some other room, the way we meander into the museum, other rooms as well. So the whole purpose is going to change, not from the first three steps as we see, but because the learning objectives and the objectives of the exhibit are more or less, like we can say that yes, but the learning outcomes, it's something that we need to specify when we are talking of the learning objectives here. And yes, aggregate, we'll have to collect a lot of things, and then we will need to filter them out. Now, when we filter them out, it would be essentially based on the learning outcome that we desire and the learning objectives that we have framed. So I think since all of us are educators with experience and at different levels, we all know how to do this. Now comes the organizing part, as we all have said that, yes, we need to also organize it. But then how do we organize it, right? Okay, let me just have a chat. I can see a message in the chat here. So just give me a moment. Some message here. Yes. Okay, that was the same, very problematic. What is going to be without appreciating the local context? Yes. So when we have organized it as per the objectives and keeping in mind the students' affordances and our affordances, we can find out the gaps. Definitely there are going to be gaps. You cannot have seamless things. Everything is not there. But yes, we can say that 90% of the things are ready by now. So whatever those 10% things are there, we need to now create only that much. So the first load that, oh my God, I have to create the entire course, that just is reduced from 100% to 10%. But now comes, what do we do? Is it that easy? See, the moment we talk to, you know, educators and educational managers, that there is a lot of content and we are going to create only 10 videos. The first question is, oh, is that going to be only 10 videos? Then you don't have any work. Well, actually the work begins after the third step. And that is a whole lot of work. Because like Derek had said, without contextualization, it's just not going to matter at all, because then it would be so alien that learning is not going to happen. So the step number four is what is it all about. That is, we have to contextualize and we have to add value to it. So even when we go to a museum, it's not just an exhibit put up. We also have that there is some information written there. We do take notes. There is an usher there, or maybe nowadays we have audio guides, which will give us more information about the exhibit. And we can just go through it. And we should always come back with more questions and a curiosity and an inquisitive mind after we visit any art gallery or any museum. Otherwise, it's just an information, you know, overload, much of which will be lost by the time 1 hour is also gone. And the same thing happens with the online course also, if we do not contextualize or add value. And most importantly, like we discussed some time back, that we need to have interactions. Interactions, student and instructor, as well as student-student. So the whole purpose or the whole onus on the teachers will begin from the step four. Of course, all this step one, step two, step three is a huge amount of work, because like we said in the second slide itself, that is the introductory slide, 500 hours of content every minute it's being put up on YouTube. I mean, how much can we even make Boolean strings to, you know, identify the exact resource that we want? That's really a mammoth task in itself. And then to organize it after that, though the ladder becomes narrower, it means it becomes more focused. So now that we have the content, what we are going to do in today's workshop is to add learner centricity. There are going to be lots and lots of models that will be there for learner centricity. But what we would like you to have is just pause and try to answer this in terms of A, B, C, D in the chat. I look forward to the answers. That if you find multiple resources for your domain, excellent content, but how will you apply it in your course if you're going to curate an entire course? I'm looking for the answers. What strategy will you apply? Will you start grading C and D, says Madhuri. Rekha, ma'am, says last, D. Okay. Okay, I'm very curious. So I'm just asking you, why not grade the participation? Wouldn't, like, you know, it's a very typical of almost all the teachers that, you know, listen to me, this is very important. I'll give you extra marks for that. Or you're going to get marks for this. This is very important with respect to the exam. So why not grade the participation also? I'm just curious to know. Does grading help or grading won't help? All depending on the course. Of course, all depending on the course. But still, will grading help or not? Let's talk in terms of, you know, a very generic statement as such. What if I tell you that right now, if you don't chat, I'll not give you marks? Suppose if this were a course, then grading will help to check their understanding